Welcome to the new episode of I Like Records.
Today, we're going to talk about the fastest speed. Not 16, not 33 and a third, not 45. Now we're going all the way. 78 RPM.
Are you listening, Duncan? Because I'm going to get into some geek talk now. It's very, very important. I want to talk a little bit about records and how they started, okay? So when they first invented it, and really if you think about it, it's one of the most incredible analog inventions they ever came up with. Basically taking sound and taking a nail vibrating at a very high rate of speed into a blank surface and imprinting sound into this little squiggly line. And then when you played the thing back with a playback type of nail, it reproduced the sound. I mean, it's incredible. But when they first invented the process, they were on those old cylinder type records. Maybe you've seen those in an antique mall or something like that. So in the early 1900s, a guy figured out, hey, we can make these flat like a pancake. And a lot of the original ones were just one-sided. They were blank on the other side. And by doing that, it allowed them to mass produce the records. They invented a record press where they could, you know, take a stamping die and, you know, put hot shellac and vinyl and wax and what, you know, the early 78s were made up of all kinds of different materials, but they could mass produce them and make hundreds or thousands of copies from one metal stamper. Are you still listening? I don't want to catch you sleeping. Pay attention. Here is a very early one-sided record. You can see it's got a trademark and this big stamp. It was very, very official stuff. It's a Victor record recording of a choir at the Sistine Chapel in Rome. And one thing that I wanted to talk about is that early 78s and early, you know, the earlier ones on the cylinder discs, they were acoustic recordings, which means they were made without the use of electricity. And perhaps you've seen the pictures of an entire orchestra all sort of gathered around a big horn, and they're all performing into the horn. That's when they were making acoustic recordings. Those are not great sounding records, and I'll sort of demonstrate by playing you a few of these early acoustic recordings. You can hear that the sound is pretty faint. They couldn't get a whole lot of volume with acoustic recordings. But, you know, even saying all that, it's pretty amazing that here's something that they produced in the very early 1900s. It's well over 100 years old, and you can still put it on a record player and listen to it today. Can I have your attention, please? Listen to me, I'm trying to tell you about 78 RPM records, Duncan. So these type of records were made acoustically and they were played back acoustically. You know, they were played on Victrola machines that you cranked up by hand that had like a spring wound motor on them. It was pre-electricity. Electricity was coming in, but they didn't really use it for recording yet. And here's a Hawaiian guitar solo. Again, another acoustic recording. And you know, what was interesting about when these type of records became available is, you know, this is the first time that a lot of people across America heard Hawaiian music or, you know, heard all these different other types of music. And it was definitely a way for music to get spread out, you know, in places where they had never heard it. And so those records influenced a lot of things that came later. So before we go any further, I should talk a little bit about 78 records and how they were cut back in the day. We already talked about how they were primitive technology compared to what we have now. And they were cut with a very wide and deep groove. And so in order to properly play back 78s, you really need a 78 needle or stylus. And I use these Shure cartridges. They're not like the greatest hi-fi thing, but the nice thing about them is that you can switch out the needles or styluses. Okay, if I'm going to use a car analogy, using a modern stereo needle to play an old 78, it's kind of like taking a big 18-wheeler truck and putting one of those tiny little spare tires that come in new cars now that aren't meant to drive on. You can kind of drive on it, but you're not supposed to. That's the way it is if you're trying to put one of those little 1 millimeter stereo needles in a big wide 3 millimeter groove cut for 78 RPM. Oh man, I hate working on cars. Here is a sort of modern elliptical needle that you would use to play stereo records, you know, like stereo albums. Works great for that, but not so great if you want to play 78s. If you want to play 78s properly, you need to invest in a 78 needle, something that's wide, like a 3 millimeter needle. You got to think in terms of the thing that recorded the groove, which was a great big cutting stylus. And then you got to think in terms of what's playing back the groove, which is your needle on your record player. So those 78 records were cut with a great big old mono cutting stylus, and they were intended to be played back with a great big needle. So when you play it with a modern stereo small needle that's meant to play in a micro groove record album, it does ride in the groove, but it's hitting all the wrong spots in the groove that it was intended to. So you get a lot more surface noise and scratches, and it's just not the full sound that 78 RPM records can actually deliver. Oh man, I hate working on cars. By 1925, they had invented an electrical type of recording where they were using microphones and amplifiers to make sound recordings, and also an electrically charged cutting device to actually cut the records. So I'm going to play you one more acoustic recording. This is a blues record from 1923. And just to, again, hear how acoustic recordings sounded. So when they did invent electrical recording, I don't know if any of you guys watched that PBS series, American Epic, but they sort of demonstrated how they did those first electrical recordings in that program. It was really excellently well done. Basically, you know, they would have one microphone and just one microphone preamp, and they would make people move around the room until they got the levels that they wanted. But they were actually able to get more high fidelity sounding recordings and louder recordings. And so you'll hear when you start playing these electrical records from the late 20s, 1930s, they're much louder and they have more fidelity to them. Has more of the sound like you're actually in the room with the artist rather than sounding like they're far away somewhere. So when we really talk about the popular era of 78 RPM records, we're talking about the 1930s through the 1950s. And a big part of that popularity was jukeboxes, because jukeboxes for the most part played 78 RPM records. And this is really difficult for us to think about in the modern era, but you know, before there was the internet and before there was television and you know, before there was everything available at our fingertips, a lot of people heard records for the first time getting played on jukeboxes. And that was one of the main things that they paid attention to when they called a record a hit. They actually had like a jukebox chart. So getting played on the jukeboxes was very important. And especially for the type of music that a lot of us really love, which I guess you would call sort of low-class music, you know, blues and country and hillbilly and that sort of thing. Those records were not getting played a lot on fancy $1,000 record player setups in rich people's houses. Those records were getting played on jukeboxes in dive bars and juke joints, and they had to be loud. That's what I'm getting at. That's the point I'm trying to make, is that at one point, the loudness of the record mattered more than the fidelity of the record, because these things were going to get played in noisy jukeboxes. And that's where you enter into a whole different kind of soundscape, for lack of a better term, is these guys who were making these records, they really didn't care about art. They didn't care about music or culture or any of that stuff. They cared about making money. And so when these guys would press up these blues records or hillbilly records, the thing that really mattered was how loud they were, more than anything else. You know, they didn't really care if they had a high fidelity sound to them. They just needed to be loud so that people could hear them on jukeboxes. So when the guys were cutting these records intended for jukeboxes, blues records and hillbilly records and things like that, they started really kind of over-amplifying things and sort of just making them sound really blown out. Because you can't, with the technology they had at the time, you couldn't really make a loud record that was also high fidelity. You had to sort of make a choice. And so they started making these records that were just blown out sounding things. And when it came to music like blues, that sounded so good. There was something about a blues 78 when it was just cranked and everything was kind of getting that distortion sound to it, that it just added to it. It did not distract from the music. Somehow it added to it. When they played these things on jukeboxes, this music just came screaming out of those jukeboxes. It must have sounded, man, it must have just sounded like bombs going off. And then the humans said,
"Womp, womp, 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 womp."
Surface to noise was a big thing, and basically what that means is there's a inherent level of noise when you play a record. When you drop that needle in a blank groove, there's going to be some amount of hiss there. And those early acoustic recordings couldn't get the volume up to where you heard the music way over the hiss sound, right? That's the surface to noise ratio. And when they invented electrical recordings, they were able to greatly increase the surface to noise ratio, and you could hear a lot more music and a lot less noise. Of course, now with digital technology, we have a surface to noise ratio that's basically no noise whatsoever, which is kind of incredible. But in those early analog days, that was always a big consideration, was the surface to noise. And that's why they went from making acoustic records to electric records, and went from 78s to 45s to 33s to reel-to-reel tapes to CDs and so forth.
I think it's important to have the perspective when you play an old blues record like the one we're about to play. These records were not made for suburban people to play on their nice record players and sit around and talk about their jolly good blues 78s. These records were made for like a really hardcore audience that listened to them in juke joints and, you know, dive bars. And the musicians that made them, you know, guys like Sonny Boy Williamson, man, they would knife you. They would kill you. They would shoot you. They were drunk most of the time. That was just part of the deal. They were basically like sort of the hip-hop gangster rap dudes of back in the day. It was very, very hard scene. And the people that made those records, the people that ran the recording studios, and the people that ran the record labels, and the people who distributed the records, it was all a real cutthroat business.
it was not a nice business at all. You know, the parallels between the modern day gangster rap, hip hop kind of thing are very, very similar to back then. So I just always keep that in mind when you play a record like this. You know, like this was hardcore black music for black people. This was never intended for white people to play in their nice little houses on their nice little record players. Okay, now with all that talking about 78 records and blues record labels and all that kind of stuff, let's get down to actually playing a record, because that's what this series is all about. Here's one of my favorite blues records, All My Love in Vain by Sonny Boy Williamson. And I'm hoping that the scratchiness of this record will keep it from getting pulled by the bots. We'll see. That's part of the reason why I'm playing such a beat-up record. But, you know, think about this record just screaming out of a jukebox in a southern juke joint, because that's what it was intended for. And the fidelity on this record is not great, but that didn't matter, because when that harmonica blows, man, it came out there like a horn, you know what I mean? It was just right in your face. Here we go.
Because he believes in justice and a woman is the glory for man.
And that concludes this episode of I Like Records, 78 RPM edition. We'll play some more 78 records later on, but this was a good one to start with. Hope you enjoyed it.
Mama ain't gonna be your old wake up no more. Mama, I ain't gonna be your old wake up.